Okay, so how do you get started with Y86? So the first thing you're going to want to do is log into Stu and run this script. So just type this in the command line and run it. And what this is going to do is it's going to add a directory to your path environment variable. And the directory that it's adding is the directory that has all the Y86 executables in it. So basically, this is going to give you access to three very useful utilities. So the first one is YAS, which is the Y86 assembler. So you would run this on your Y86 code, which we store in .ys files. And this will assemble it into two output files. So there are actually two different forms of object output files. One is a .yo format, and one is a .o format. So the second utility that is going to be useful is the reference solution to projects 3 and 4. So this is a compiled version of my solution for Y86. It's actually the entire project sequence from project 1 and through project 4. And so you can run this, and this will give you the reference output. So this is what you're aiming for in project 3 and 4. So if you run with dash little d, it will run the disassembly. If you run it with dash little e, then it will do execution. It will actually interpret and run the program. If you use capital E, it'll give you trace mode, where it will actually show you how the machine state is changing after every single instruction, and it will also give you a memory dump at the end. So that uses the .o file, so that's a compiled object file that's stored in binary format. There's also a .yo output file, which is sort of object code stored in text format, and this is useful for running the textbook hardware simulator. So your textbook authors have provided a hardware simulator for you, and it's called YSim, and it runs on those YO files, and it basically steps through an actual machine and simulates running that actual machine. It does have a visual mode, but you have to have X11 forwarding enabled in order to do that, which means you'll need to add the dash Y flag when you SSH to Stu. Feel free to post on Piazza if you're having issues with that. So I really highly recommend that you become familiar with all three of these tools. Probably the first two are going to be the most useful to you as you work on the projects, but you really want to become comfortable with using these. There is also a web-based simulator that you might find useful just when you're working on the lab for today. I would use a little bit of caution with this simulator. So this is a JavaScript-based simulator. I did not write it. I basically found it from someone else, and I forked the repository. I fixed a couple of bugs, and that's why I'm a little less trustful of this one. And so if there is a discrepancy, I would say trust the reference solution and the simulator over this web-based one. But again, it might be useful to use this web-based interface, for instance, if you are having trouble getting to Stu. The other thing that I would point out here is that neither simulator, so neither the hardware simulator that your textbook authors provided or the web-based simulator, support the IO trap instruction. That's something that we've added for this course. And so only the reference solution is going to support that. Okay, so let me quickly show you what the web-based simulator looks like. So this is the code that we saw in the previous video. It's over here. I know this is a little bit small. Perhaps in the video it might not be readable, but unfortunately the way that the window is laid out, I can't really make it much larger and still be able to see everything. So what you do is you click assemble, and that runs the assembler and generates the output over here. And then you can step through it and run the code one instruction at a time. You see all the register values here, the flags, the status, and then you can scroll through memory over here on the right side. So again, if you find that useful, that's great. Now I'm going to show you how to use the command line tools on Stu, which I think probably will be a little bit more powerful and more useful to you as you work on the projects. All right, so I have prepared an example on Stu. So you can see I have an add.ys file here, and if we take a look at it, we'll see that this is the code that we were looking at before. So here is the program, and then this is just a little bit of code that makes the code work with the simulator. I'll cover that in the next video. So that's the code that adds two numbers together, so 7 and 2. So the first thing that we want to do is to assemble it. And you can do that just by running the YAS command. If this gives you an error, then this means that you have not been able, you have not successfully run that setup or install script yet. And so if you have trouble with that, feel free to ask on Piazza or come to office hours. But it should just run like that, and you'll notice that it creates two new files. So it creates a .o and a .yo. The .yo is actually a text file that you can read. So this is sort of the this is textual representation of the Y86 instructions, and this is the format that the simulator accepts. So we can actually run this by passing it to the ysim command. So some of this is not terribly important right now, but you can see that it ran that jump instruction. So it started at address 0, which is not where we would start execution. We would start it here at this underscore start label. And so it runs the jump, and then it gets down to this code. So it runs the IR move Q that moves something into RAX, moves 7 into RAX. The next instruction moves 2 into RAX, and then the next instruction adds RCX into RAX, and then it gets to the halt. So it executes a total of 5 instructions. These are the condition codes at the end, and here are the registers that changed during execution and their final values. So you can see that we have the 9 in RAX, which was the 7+2. All right, so that's the .yo file, but probably what you're going to be working with more is the .o file. And the .o file is a binary file, so you could look at it with hex dump. So you could look at add.o, and this would give you the hex dump output of the file. But probably what you're going to want to do is use the disassembler on the reference solution. So this is actually what you're implementing in Project 3. So if you want to run the reference solution, then you run y86 ref, and then little d, and then the name of the file. So this is the disassembly of the results. So this is taking these binary instructions and interpreting them as Y86 instructions. And again, this is what you're going to be implementing in Project 3. You're going to be reading through and looking at the binary and interpreting it as a Y86 instruction and printing out what the instruction means. All right, so then to actually run the instruction, or to run the program, we use the execute flag, or the dash E. And this will actually go through and run the program. And you can see that it ran 4 instructions, which is one fewer than the simulator ran. And again, that's because we start at the entry point, not at address 0. And then you can see that the other stuff is still the same. So at the end, we still have a value of 9 for RAX, and we have a value of 7 for RCX. If we wanted to watch as the interpreter runs the program and see how the machine state changes after every instruction, we can do that using the trace mode. So we change the lowercase e to a capital E. And this mode gives a lot of output, so I'm going to recommend just piping it to some utility that lets you view it like less. And so here's the first page of it. So you can see that we're beginning execution at the entry point. This is the CPU state at the very beginning. We execute the IR move Q, the first IR move Q instruction, and you can see that the change is that RCX is now the value 7. And then, so again, this is a lot of output, but this is showing you the machine state after every single instruction. So you can see the next IR move Q, the add, which puts the final value of 9 in RAX, and then the halt instruction. And you can see again, this we executed 4 instructions. And then this mode also gives you a dump of the entire memory address space at the end, which is useful for debugging. All right, so that was a quick overview of the utilities that we are providing for working with Y86. I very strongly encourage you to spend some time learning how to use these and becoming familiar with them. I think that'll really make your life a lot easier as you work on projects 3 and 4.